Hello, Sector.
Sector?
Yes, Sector. Let me explain. Due to a problem with my talking computer, my V's are all being pronounced as S's.
Oh, you mean the sort of typographical conceit that sustained the two Ronnies through 48 fucking series. I know what you mean,
That's
yeah.
That's right, Sector. It has hilarious comic potential.
Well, no sign of it so far.
Because, Sector, I can say rude words like vagina and selch, and no one can stop me.
Oh, God.
Ronnie Parker told me it always gets a laugh.
Roll the titles!
Party, 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 bar, bar, bar. TV Offal, where uncompromising physical ugliness is an asset.
And this week on... Sorry about that, TV Offal. If the personalised number on your TV screen at home matches the number printed in your edition of TV Times, then you may have already won a lifetime supply of oxygen or a complete fortnight in January. But before then, we see the gay Daleks rubbing each other up the wrong way. We show you never-before-seen footage of Maestro Leonard Bernstein doing something peculiar with his mouth, and all the while I'll be eating raw Pop-Tarts while performing an act that will probably lead to zinc deficiency. Remember, we always prosecute, but we start with yet more famous people ritually devouring themselves in our very own kamikaze karaoke.
If you want to know what the stars really sound like, here's your chance with kamikaze karaoke.
Hey kids, when I die, I want to die like Elvis. 43 stones, stuffed full of drugs and cheeseburgers, and sitting on the bog with me kecks around me ankles. Some people say that Elvis was the king. But I've always been a staunch Republican where Mr. Presley is concerned, so this is how he sounds to me.
Well, baby, if a man is your man, for something I might have said, please don't forget the past, the future's right ahead. I don't want no fucking love. Baby, it's just a you I'm thinking of.
Don't believe me about Presley's obsession with hamburgers? Well, didn't you ever hear a song he made called
Love Meat Tender, Love Meat True, Whip Pan, Thank You?
But change his tone of voice to somber stop as we learn of the death of yet another start famous celebrity, and this stop is how I imagine Michael Burke start announcing the tragic news. Stop, start.
Jeremy Beadle,
who died today.
It was only this week that TV presenter Jeremy Beadle was filmed doing what he liked best, sitting at home watching videotapes of the TV presenter Jeremy Beadle. Some said he was a fat, untalented, sadistic, pointy-bearded, short-assed, common-as-muck wide boy of a human grease gun whose only pleasure was tormenting gormless members of the public. His critics were less kind. Many suggested that his hoaxing fixation was due to his withered hand, which, like his sense of humour, had never grown up and remained forever schoolboy-sized. Born Jeremy Beadle, Jeremy Beadle spent his childhood in Penury, a charming coastal town in Cornwall. But there was tragedy because, like his hero, Nietzsche, he was picked on by other children because of his deformity. However, unlike his hero, Nietzsche, he did not take revenge against humanity by writing apocalyptic philosophy, but by hosting imbecilic TV shows. Beadle perfected an ingenious TV format where you, the public, were the stars, yet he and the production company took the lion's share of the money.
Please, please keep sending in those wonderful clips, and who knows, next time, the star of the show could be you!
Many viewers complained that pranks were so contrived that they didn't just strain credulity.
Do you know that you've got lipstick all over your ear?
They left it with a double hernia and needing a truss. But like many intellectuals, he adored alliteration, always denying that it was easier than thinking of real jokes.
The menagerie of feline follies, canine catastrophes and fluffy foul-ups. Cocktail of classic calamities, your favourite flock of four-legged friends.
Some said of his practical jokes that if the victim's IQ was really as low as it appeared to be, then he might as well have gone the whole hog and filmed the mentally subnormal. Or like this chap, merely physically challenged. But the public eventually tired of his routines and said it was high time that Beadle was no longer about. His audience turned against him. Seemingly missing from British TV, he took refuge in vile acts of bestiality and was forced to flee the country. He left Britain in the Beadle's About helicopter, tragically forgetting that it was fitted with a joke ejector seat. Somewhere over the channel, he accidentally pressed the button, and a split second before the helicopter exploded, he was shot clean through the rotor blades and emerged as 380 pounds of finely chopped bearded salami. He leaves two gloves, one large, one small. Jeremy Beadle, who died today.
TV Offal's found another crappy logo of the week.
This is Harlech Television's headquarters in 1967. Its dreary programmes caused vomiting and nausea in viewers, so what better than a logo to match? But hold fast! We have another dreadful logo this week, belonging to yet another student TV station. This week, it's Stoic, broadcasting from their crack studio at Imperial College, London.
Standby studio, cue jingle.
But what did we find in their archives? Dear, multimillionaire weatherman Piers Corbyn in his Marxist Dave Spart period, sporting a fright wig, and accompanied by other human poodles. A performance by a band called Sick, with a guest appearance by Michael Hutchins on guitar, long before the business with the leather belt. Now that's what I call room service. And a youthful Mark Lawson, sporting a set of child-bearing lips. Put it this way, push the boy's mouth against a plate glass window, and he'd have stuck to it and dangled for 6 hours. Not to forget guest appearances by the stars! Oh, and Mike Yarwood.
He didn't know. He didn't...
I'll just ask the question.
Sorry.
Why was this interview so incoherent? I blame drink!
Unfortunately for the agents, bollocks!
Because we dress up in drag,
bollocks! That fucking thing doesn't scan. It doesn't scan!
Here, I've got a good idea. Why don't we have an old-fashioned sing-along? Well, fuck you then.
How tragic. If you ask me, at the time of these performances, he was a complete piss artist! Not long now until we show you the late Leonard Bernstein performing orally on the television. Disgusting.
They're camp, they exterminate, and they watch your backs. It's the gay darlings.
It's time for another adventure with the celestial gay stereotypes as they penetrate a red dwarf from behind in... in their galactic cruiser, the TARDIS.
He has left me. I was too old and rattled, he said. So he has left and gone off with a chicken. I gave him the best years of my life. I still remember the night we met. It was so romantic. He offered me 2 hot days between the sheets. Then he stuck me in the airing cupboard for the weekend. We went through the good times and the bad. He taught me all the words to go west and Oklahoma. And when he was arrested for cottaging in Gloucester Public Laboratory, I managed to convince the police that he had simply slid on some sick in the cubicle and fell. How we laughed so long ago. So long ago. And now I'm left on the shelf without a friend to cuddle up to at night. Nobody loves a rattled, clapped-out old Dalek queen. Boo-hoo, I need a paper hanky. Oh, sod it. I'll have a wank.
Assassination of the week. Did they live? Or are they one food?
Here this week, the light entertainment quiz show with the emphasis on premeditated homicide and no-nonsense disembowelment takes you to the only Catholic country in Asia for a thriller in Manila. This is footwear crazy Imelda Marcos, wife of the ex-Filipino president, but no one wanted to be in her shoes during a Meet the People electioneering jaunt back in 1985 when this gentleman decided to question her economic policy in a way that even Jeremy Paxman would consider impertinent. Did the First Lady of the Philippines wish for once that she hadn't got a full 9 inches thrusting inside her? Or was it just a trick rubber blade that only went boing against her stomach? In short, was she about to become a past tense person? Find out after the break.
The Daily Mirror calls on you.
Who? Us?
Yes, and millions of other young people like you.
Hey, you two, cut it out. You're the Daily Mirror, aren't you? Can't you stop them?
Stop you, more like it.
What?
Well, why spoil their fun?
I never carried on like that.
And look at the mess you made of things. Oh, don't worry about him. The Daily Mirror believes in young people, and that means you. What's your job?
I'm at a technical college, an engineering course.
I'm training to be a nurse.
They look fine to us, these citizens of tomorrow. Play hard and work hard is a darn good motto. Go on, have fun. The Daily Mirror backs the young because the young are alive. The Daily Mirror's a lively paper for lively people. So have the Daily Mirror call on you again tomorrow. The biggest daily sale on Earth.
TV Offal.
Welcome back. At the end of part one, we asked you whether Imelda Marcos, the shoe-loving First Lady of the Philippines, had popped her clogs. Or did the assassination attempt turn out to be a load of cobblers? Let's see. Whoop. Oh. Oh, dear. Uh-oh. Well, he certainly had her in stitches. 75 stitches, to be precise. But at least she survived. Unlike the failed assassin, who soon had his head ventilated by the Manila police in a you-won't-be-doing-that-again-will-you-sir sort of way. Join us again next time for more vaudeville-style carnage, when, once again, we'll be taking a sideways look at the lighter side of gratuitous political violence and asking the vital question, is he worm food?
Kamikaze karaoke!
I wouldn't want to die like Jimi Hendrix. He drowned in a pool of his own vomit, you know. Just think, oh, it must have taken a lot of vomit to fill up a pool. He must have had a very big curry beforehand, probably a mushroom biryani with dal and sagaloo and some extra poppadoms, all washed down with a few pints of lager and all of them filling time with verbal kapok, because the producer tells me we're running slightly under time this week. However, the producer is now nodding frantically at me and telling me to get a move on, so change his voice to sound more authoritative. Although some people regard Jimi Hendrix as the most revolutionary musician in the history of rock, I've no time for his drug-crazed, libidinous, back-to-front guitar strumming, which is why this is how he sounds to me.
Little hairs all in my brain. Lately things just don't seem the same. Acting funny, but I don't know why. Excuse me while I kiss this guy. Little hairs all awry. Don't know if I'm coming up or dying. Just the end of time!
Did you know that Jimi Hendrix used to play the guitar with his teeth? It's true. I can do it too.
Oh, hang on. I'll just take out the upper and lower set out. Oh, there you are. I'll move them to strum this guitar.
And now I'll play them like castanets. Olay! Funny, isn't it, how flamenco dancers shout with milk at the end of every song. Olé, they shout with milk.
Don't forget, coming up soon, Maestro Bernstein will be giving one of the most sensational performances of his entire career. Sorry to interrupt you masturbating. Sorry, so sorry. But apropos of nothing again, does the phrase Maori parpurns mean anything to you? Think it's a rare New Zealand tribe, or perhaps an onomatopoeic word to describe a mass attack of Aboriginal flatulence? No, Maori parpurns is in fact the phonetic spelling of how Dick Van Dyke, and who hasn't, how Dick Van Dyke pronounced the name of the eponymous star of the film Mary Poppins.
Maori Parfums.
Plucky Britain quietly bided its time in the face of this linguistic outrage and awaited the chance of revenge for Mr. Van Dyke's infamous Cockney pronunciation, and that chance finally came in 1994 in the shape of the second worst cereal ever made, Honey for Tea, a BBC fiasco in which Felicity Kendall attempted an American accent but ignominiously crash-landed midway across the Atlantic.
Gee, I'm sorry, Professor Weatherstone.
It really leads to frothing at the mouth.
Are you in the closet?
You will have noticed that I said Honey for Tea was the second worst cereal ever made. Ergo, there must have been an even worse one. Ergo, there is one that was so dire that it never even made it to the screen. Ergo, I must stop saying ergo all the time. So let me take you by the hand and lead you through the streets of Nigeria for this week's Pilot That Crashed. If you'll bear with me, kids, I'm just microwaving a fresh title sequence for you. There you are. Good and tasty and piping hot and full of ns.
And now it's time to show the secret films. The clips, the stars, hope we never see. The shows that failed, derailed, and never made it to our screens. We bring you the pilots that
it ill behoves the monoglottal English to make mock of another nation's attempts to speak a foreign language. But this, the Nigerian Television Authority's answer to Coronation Street, was written in several different languages simultaneously, yet failed to make sense in any of them. I won't bore you with the plot, except to say that it involves a mysterious chicken strangulation, a court messenger wantonly snorting cocaine in court, and a clerk of the court who utters the mysterious line, "Shut up, grammatic oil."
Shut up, grammatic oil.
But not even a tankerload of grammatic oil could have saved the Nigerian actor who pluckily attempted the role of a white English colonial judge and delivered such choice lines of British legalese as, "Pussycats and dogs started to rain jumping from the sky."
"I wanted to come on, but started raining lots and lots everywhere."
"This is a cock and bull story."
"This is cock and bull story."
And "She wanted to buy corrugated iron sheds."
"Oh, she wanted to buy corrugated iron sheds?"
For no apparent reason, all the while collecting the clerk of the court's grammar.
"To stand well like other men in the country."
"Other men."
"Other men."
And wearing the unlikely combo of a pith helmet, Sherlock Holmes calabash pipe and pinstripe suit, his speech full of sound and fury and signifying nothing.
"If you don't tell me the truth, I will send you to prison."
Insensible, irascible, rambling, incomprehensible. Perhaps this actor has captured the essence of the British judiciary after all. Throughout the case, the cocaine-snorting court messenger has been shouting louder.
"Louder!"
Whenever he wants people to be quiet. He means silence, of course, but judicial systems throughout the world often get opposites confused, like, say, innocent and guilty. Guilty. If you do not wish to know the outcome of the first episode of this aborted soap, look away now. Rightio. Member of the cast fell asleep during taping, the case was dismissed, the chicken strangler was convicted on evidence of a beak peck and was handed a bribe by the judge, and the show ended with the pair of them eloping. The joys of British civilization. For decades, we stole raw materials from our colonies, and now, even though they've kicked us out, we can still steal a cheap laugh at their expense. And may I say, how pleasant it's been to fill your screen with a minute's worth of crass funny foreigner jokes, thinly disguised as satire. Oh yes, they don't call me Bernard Manning with all levels for nothing, kids. Pulls the skin right back and moves on with tears streaming freely from his eyes.
The dawn is breaking and the nation awakes to one of nature's cruelest mistakes.
It's nice being Chris. The poison carrier who made it big. It's nice being Chris. Heaven's above, it's a ginger pig.
Hero to the stupid, he gets their votes. He's proof of the theory, the job he's always slow.
He has tantrums, he's vulgar, his show's a mess. Insanity without the S.
I've had a good booze and I'm currently under the tape.
A wannabe David Letterman, yet he always forgets to include the brain. But it's when he tries to be like Howard Stern that he really makes our stomachs turn.
We're the same, but unlike you, I have some morals. I didn't dump my wife.
Ah, no! Well,
it's nice being Chris.
So nice.
He's surrounded by acolytes. It's nice being Chris.
So nice.
With his unnatural whining voice.
Wheel! 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 Wheel!
Now we must stop, because our lawyer says that Chris
right, stand back. There's nothing more to see. Go on, piss off. All right, I'm vile. But you spend 5 years in the Boy Scouts sleeping in the lower bunk underneath a bedwetter and see how you turn out. But good God, that's about it for this week, kids. But next week, there'll be jelly and balloons. And we'll also be trying a scientific experiment in the TV Offal studio. We all know that a dropped cat always lands on its feet and that dropped toast always lands butter side down. So I propose to strap a piece of buttered toast to the back of a cat with the batter facing upwards and then drop the cat. My scientific theory is that the cat and the toast should both hover, spinning, inches above the ground. But who's this just come into the studio?
Victor?
Yes?
This is Redvers Kyle speaking. I was one of the original announcers for Associated-Rediffusion in the 1950s, you know.
I do know, Redvers. You are a living legend.
Thank you. Are you going to make one of those rather unamusing phone calls now, Victor?
Would you like me to make a call, Redvers?
Not really.
So be it.
Colchester, 23.
Oh, hello, is that Mary Whitehouse?
Who's speaking?
Forgive me for phoning you at home, Mary.
It's all right.
My name is Frank Jism. Have you heard of Face magazine?
Oh, yes, go on.
All right, well, I edit an Islamic fashion magazine called The Shiite Face. Our aim is to put the fun back into fundamentalism. And I'm phoning...
Face or pace?
Face.
F.
I'm not phoning for abuse.
F.
Pardon?
So, which magazine?
No, not which magazine. They test the suck of hoovers, don't they?
Carry on.
Mary, hold on a second. Keep the noise down.
It feels so good in my ass.
Sorry, I'm phoning from home at the moment. Can I apologise for the noises off? My wife, Rona's in the next room.
It feels so good.
She's with her personal fitness trainer,
yes.
Winston.
Oh, yes. Oh, is she?
And the walls
well,
are paper
thin. Well, if my husband was here, he'd say wives do make a lot of noise.
Sorry. Please yes. Forgive me for phoning
no,
you at home.
No, it's perfectly all right.
All right.
Yes, right
I couldn't. I didn't want to put it in writing. I'm phoning with good news, because our readers have voted you winner of the Mohammed Welch Prize for purity in the media. And
never.
Yes, and it carries a substantial financial prize.
Well, it's marvellous. What is it?
I'm sorry?
What is it?
Right, well, the actual prize.
Yes. You better tell me how much.
Sorry?
You better tell me.
Oh, right. It's... Let me just check.
Tell me.
It's £22,000.
Good gracious me.
So I don't know if you want to give that to charity or you can spend it yourself, but may I take this opportunity to thank you for spending the last three decades, you know, ridding...
Oh, that's very kind of you.
Ridding our TV sets of a Niagara of filth, really.
Yes.
All those years of watching pornography on our behalf, you haven't been depraved or corrupted one iota.
Yes.
Now, can I send you the cheque to your agent, or is there...
Oh, no, send it direct to me.
Could you hold on a second, please?
Yes.
Rona?
Oh, that big dick in my ass.
Please be quiet, would you? She's coming, I think. She said she's coming.
Oh, yeah. Oh. What are you saying?
I do forgive you. One final thing. You must be very disappointed with your son, Paul Whitehouse, haven't you? He's turned to be out to be a bit of a foul-mouthed lout.
You mean a Paul Whitehouse that sometimes does things on television?
That is Marty Whitehouse, isn't it? I'm
no,
talking to...
No, that's not my son.
No, I'm not your son, dear. Am I speaking to Marty Whitehouse?
No, you've got Mary Whitehouse.
Oh.
Now, am I getting a prize or aren't I?
No, no prize for you, my dear. Pardon? Hello?
Associated Rediffusion.